it all relates to becoming a helicopter pilot. It ain't easy, but you can do it. And all the naysayers, oh, you know, blah, blah, blah. Well, what career in life do you just automatically pay money and get what you want? No career works like that. It doesn't matter what career you're going for, what you want to do in life, working for somebody else, creating your own business, getting your helicopter license, becoming a career pilot. What the hell? Whoever said that, oh, hey, I just get your license and jobs will just land in your lap. No, that's with any freaking opportunity. That's with anything. So why people expect helicopters to be an easy road among any other profession is really beyond me. Hey, how about coffee with Kenny on the hogs cart today? We go out and check out the yard, preparing to land in the yard for the next day or two. Sounds like fun, and we're gonna do that. I'm Kenny Keller, creator of Helicopter Land Ground School. Welcome to day 160 of Coffee with Kenny. Started 3 months ago on a beautiful February day. Normally the weather sucks in February, but we had a beautiful day, and I went out and did coffee with Kenny with this cup from the Keurig and the K-Cups, Kenny Keller. And I just thought, this is kind of fun. And then within a few days, they started calling it Coffee with Kenny. The viewers did. Never set out to do this as a daily video. And it just happened, right? Some of the coolest things in life are unplanned, right? Always is. So we're gonna go out in the hogs cart in just shortly and prep you for coming in, landing in the yard. I promised that this past winter during Coffee with Kenny. So we'll go out and look at the obstacles and kind of plan our path in and our path out, talk about it, and then I'll film that and we'll have it up for you this weekend. How's that sound? We're gonna do it. And I'm also gonna go out and do a 0.7 check ride, meaning the one examiner I've used for 20 years, his check rides always come out 0.7. No matter what you're doing, no matter what the check ride is, if there was ever one that wasn't 0.7, I sure don't remember in 20 years. So I want to show you how quick a check ride can really go. So the dreaded private pilot check ride, oh my God, it's so horrible. You know, depends on the examiner and depends on how prepared you are. If you're really prepared, your oral could be, you know, hour, hour and a half, 2 hours. Your flight could be 0.7. And you could be done in 3 hours. Some examiners takes all day. Just depends, but it also depends on you. So I wanna answer a question, and it's kind of lengthy, but I wanna read it to you because this is pertinent, and we've covered these things in the last 160 days. Maybe Shelby hasn't been watching all of them. Either way, this question keeps coming up in different forms and fashions, but this is for those of you going for a career. What helicopter should I fly? Where should I go fly? So I'm going to read you the question just because so many of you will be interested in this. Hi, Kenny. I'm not doing training right now. The weather in Colorado is very uncooperative, and I'm not with your ground school yet either, which is okay. Not every single viewer of our YouTube channel is a member. We highly recommend it, and I'll answer your questions for you. And Shelby, I suggest once you get flying, you join Helicopter Land Ground School to help you get through the training. But I had a question, and if it's not appropriate to answer, that's fine too. I'm looking at schools in Florida because of the weather, and there seems to be more schools, which I would say is probably true. In Colorado, there are only two, and they are a great distance apart, so I feel like it'd take forever to get my training done. And since I don't live in Colorado regularly, I decided to try Florida. Okay? You've got a plan. I want to make this a career, so the plan is to go through the private, instrument, and commercial, CFI, etc. Some schools offer R22, R44, and I saw one that also offers training in a Cabri. I know the costs are very different, but what would be most effective? And if I plan to make it a career, Also, I plan to do work overseas as well, and I know the licensing agencies are different and such, but some jobs want you to have experience with this type of heli or that type of heli, etc., which we've covered in the past in a previous video. What would be the most efficient combination or training which you would recommend? I hope that makes sense. I plan to do the training to the private pilot in at least one go, which is great. So I'm saving the money now to get the license within 3 to 4 months this fall, which is a great plan. I tell people, attack the private first. You get overwhelmed trying to figure out how to do all the ratings and all the money. Focus on the private, get that done and then move on. I think that's a great plan. So Shelby's, you know, formulating a plan, and that's really good. And I understand the question. So I believe I already read this, and I plan to do the training of the PPL at least in one go, saving the money now to get the license in 3 to 4 months this fall, instead of doing it in one or two lessons a week. correct. One or two lessons a week, you can do it. You can certainly do it. But your progress at 1 to 2 times a week is just not going to be real efficient, real productive, and not going to be productive for your money. I'd plan to do 3 to 5 half days of training, okay? That's a good plan, 3 to 5 days. If you could get in there 3 to 5 days a week, that's pretty darn good. You're going to make progress at that. Again, not saying you can't do 1 to 2, but your progress is going to be slow. So, okay, Shelby, you got a pretty good plan so far. When it comes to picking the different helicopters, you know, different places charge different amounts. And I hate to say this, but you know what? You got to really look at what you want to do, and the money has got to be kind of a, the money is a factor, but don't make the money the determining factor. You know, the determining factor is where do you really want to work and what do you really want to fly? Hands down, this is without argument, Robinson Helicopters is the number one civil aircraft in the world, okay? And whether a lot of people don't like Robinson, but the fact is it is the most popular trainer. So people are training most generally in the R22 and R44. So if you get time in those aircraft, you're gonna be more marketable. That's just the way it is. Now the Cabri, it's gaining popularity. I know I've watched it in the last year or two, and I've been hearing about the Cabri for 5 years or so, or even a little bit more, but it really seems like it's gained a lot of momentum in the last year or two, and it continues to gain momentum. But it's going to take time for them to build the aircraft. Chris Hauser was here the other day, and he said, you know, there's like 30 in the country, okay? I don't know how many Robinsons there are, but there are a ton. So nothing wrong with the Cabri. It's gaining popularity. People love it, and it will continue to. But I guess I'd say get training in all three of them if you could, and I'd even get in some instrument time in there as well and some Schweitzer. Go back and watch our videos from last weekend with Chris Hauser, who stated get as many different hours as you can, as many different aircraft. That's a good plan too. It's just, I can't answer that in one blanket question, as I've been saying a lot lately. You know, you really got to look at where in the country are you going to go fly, because that's where you're going to need to be licensed. And, you know, look for the area you really want to be in and look at some schools where you're really wanting to work. But I just think hands down right now in the world we live in, 2019, the biggest opportunities for jobs are going to be flying Robinsons. That's just the way it is, regardless of whether people like it or not. It's still the most popular helicopter, and there's a ton of them out there. So I think all in all, Shelby has a great plan, has a good start, but, you know, I'm going to go back to the video we did with Tim Tucker at Heli Expo when he shocked us all when we said, you know, we were going around to the different manufacturers, Robinson, Enstrom, Schweitzer, Cabri, and going, hey, you know, why should someone fly your aircraft over another? And it was kind of cool with Tim Tucker's response being chief pilot at Robinson Helicopter and a super experienced pilot, super experienced examiner, and everybody around the world mostly knows Tim Tucker, especially if you fly Robinsons. And when he said, you know, it doesn't really make a difference what helicopter you fly. It really doesn't, because he said the military did a study over 5 years, big helicopter, small helicopter, 3-bladed, 2-bladed. He said the results in the end really had no effect on a person's ability. It was more on, you know, a person has their own abilities. How hard do you apply yourself? How hard do you study is going to be the predominating factor in what type of a pilot you are. It's not going to be the aircraft that, particularly the aircraft that you fly in. So again, I think someone getting into the career, I'd jump around and get as many helicopters as you could. Chris said it last weekend, and I'll say it. When I went through my private, I flew Robinsons, Schweitzers, and Enstroms, and predominantly Robinson, but that Schweitzer and Enstrom time helped me a little bit later in the career, because when I went to get one job, my second CFI job, I had like 5 hours of Enstrom time. The company hired me because I had that 5 hours, right? So they didn't have to spend the 5 hours to get me, you know, the 5 hours I needed for my CFI. And same thing with the Schweitzer. Later they dumped the Schweitzer, dumped the Enstrom, bought a Schweitzer. Well, I had Schweitzer time from my private. So again, they were able to put me on the insurance. They didn't have to say, well, you got to get 5 hours in a Schweitzer before we can let you fly. So having that experience in those different aircraft did make a difference for me. And it can cost you more money in the long run, but you know what? It's, again, there's so many different factors. Shelby, you got a great plan. I'd look a little harder in what country do you really want to fly in, And, you know, what are some of the schools that you think you might want to try to go to work at? And again, I'd try to get a little time in everything. Predominantly probably Robinson, and then add some Cabri, some Schweitzer, some instrument if you can somehow swing it. Even if you get 5 hours in each, at least you've got that 5 hours minimum to teach in. And a school may say, well, all right, you got 5 hours, not a lot, but at least you have the five minimum when we can do some more training with you or whatever the case is. So I think that's a great way to go. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to bring the instrument home, land it here in the yard. And I was going to do this whole thing today, and I thought, you know what, how about just kick back today? Had a great week with Ray, and Mark's going for his check ride next week. I got a guy coming down from Michigan who flies an R44. I think he's going to be involved with Coffee with Kenny. He seemed excited about it. He wants to come down and try the instrument. He actually is a part owner of a flight school with three other guys, and they use R44s at their flight school, and he's qualified in the R44. But he wants to come down and try out the instrument. He wants to come down for 2 days. So if weather pans out, he's going to bring the R44 down. We'll slide it in the hangar. I told him, you can plug your flight school while you're here, plug what you do back in Michigan, and we'll highlight your R44 for 1 or 2 days in the Coffee with Kenny Wise here. So what we'll do, let's jump on the hogs cart and let's go look at the obstacles that we got out here. Starting off, got my house right here behind me. TV tower right here. Not a big deal. It's not really all that high, but you know, knowing all your obstacles is going to be key. I sit here on my porch all the time, look around the yard, you know, been thinking about this for quite a while, actually been living here a year. So we got a channel over there. I'm going to try to come in over when the wind's right. Some obstacles over there, but let's go take a look. All right. We're going to ease on down here with the old electric golf cart. We got this thing for the hangar, but of course, you know, I had to come home and check it out, right? I had to check it out first, test this thing out. So we're leaving my porch, heading down to the Keller Marina. It's only got a pontoon so far, but I got an old speedboat I just bought. It's out in the driveway. Needs a starter. Put a new battery in it. Starter conked out already. Whoa. Trying to not spill my coffee too much. All right, here's the center of the yard. There's my neighbor Jack over there. He works for the local police department. And city police, and then there is, just down the road the other direction, is the chief of police for the lake that I live at, just down the road. So my friend, neighbor, Jack's already talked with the chief of police for the lake area, and he said, no ordinance, no big deal. So over there's a channel. That's where I'll be coming in. The wind is off my back right now. That's to the north. I'm going to come right over that channel, and you can see nice, big, open yard. My neighbor's already prepared. He's cool with it. Over here, we got trees on this side. So we'll look that way. We're going to look over here to the south. Over here, a line of trees, and then there is a power line over there, but it's actually lower than the tops of those trees that you see. So I just want to be aware in the middle, got to remember those power lines are there. I can clear those no problem. I'm going to come in light. I won't be heavy. It won't be 90 degrees and humid. It'll be a day like right now, about 70. Just a little bit of breeze or a little bit of wind. Got the neighbor's antenna over there. So we need to look at that over this direction, past my house, the trees. Again, my TV antenna I mentioned, Jack's house. I'm gonna come in over the channel, shoot right in here to the yard. I got all kinds of room. It's much drier now, so not a big deal. Then when I go to depart, I'm gonna go that way. Now, of course, I've flown over my house many times, so I already have a path in and path out. I know what's on each side, so if I had some kind of trouble leaving, I know where I can go left or right to get down to a road or a big open yard or something that direction. All right, let's head up to the house and finish the coffee. And bam, we're back on the porch for the wrap up. So people, you're gonna have to keep tuning in. You gotta come back the next couple days to get the 0.7 check ride flight in the instrument and the flight into the yard to land. So subscribe and click the bell so you'll be notified each day of when those videos come out, and you can keep track of our Coffee with Kenny daily videos. We talk about all kinds of stuff, just like the question we answered for Shelby earlier. We talk about all kinds of stuff. So this is awesome. Many of you that have been following have heard the stories. Hard to believe 7 years ago, I was so drunk I couldn't pay attention. I mean, so broke, I couldn't pay attention. And living proof that in your late 40s, you could lose absolutely everything that you own. And then you put your nose to the grindstone and you pick yourself back up and you go back to work. I try to make these, you know, motivational too. Going for your dreams is not easy. if you're going to wait for your friends and your family to help you go for your dreams, then you might as well forget it, because it probably ain't going to happen. I mean, you might have some families that support you and your friends that support you, but in general, people don't really want to see you succeed. I think not everybody, right? But people are jealous when somebody moves on. People are jealous when somebody does well. Everybody's ready to jump on the bandwagon when you're broke and poor and, you know, crying in your beer or whatever. But the only people that can fix their problems are themselves. The only people that can fix your problems is you. And I'm living proof that, man, you just got to go for it. No matter how many times life kicks you in the frickin' rear, you got to pick yourself up by your bootstraps and go back to work or studying or whatever it is you want to do. And it all relates to becoming a helicopter pilot. It ain't easy, but you can do it. And all the naysayers, oh, you know, blah, blah, blah. Well, what career in life do you just automatically pay money and get what you want? No career works like that. It doesn't matter what career you're going for, what you want to do in life, working for somebody else, creating your own business, getting your helicopter license, becoming a career pilot. What the hell? Whoever said that, oh, hey, I just get your license and jobs will just land in your lap. No, that's with any freaking opportunity. That's with anything. So why people expect helicopters to be an easy road among any other profession is really beyond me. All right, just a freaking beautiful day out here. 160 days later, I'm still doing this. Thanks to all of you. I really have only been drinking coffee this morning. Adult beverages don't come till tonight, Friday night. All right. Well, either I bored you to death and you left a long time ago, or you're still here. So thanks for tuning in. And we would see you in day 161.